Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tinderbox, The Iroquois Theater Disaster, 1903, by Anthony P. Hatch, narrated by Matthew Josdal. We learn from history that we learn nothing from history. George Bernard Shaw. Foreword. On February 13, 1875, the Chicago Times stunned its readers by predicting a terrible theater disaster waiting to happen. In a city that only 4 years earlier had been devastated by what was called the Great Chicago Fire, the Times, in lurid detail, described a tragedy in an absolutely fireproof theater, filled to overcapacity one winter's day with women and children who were watching a musical comedy. In this fictionalized account, audience members jammed the exits in a mad rush to escape, while the show's leading comedian rushed on stage just as the fire safety curtain burst into flames. Hundreds were horribly burned, crushed to death, or asphyxiated, and the Times warned that safety provisions were generally so lax that the make-believe story could, at any time, become a reality. 28 years later, on one winter day, the nightmare prediction came true in almost every ghastly detail. Now nearly forgotten, the horror of the Iroquois Theater remains to this day the worst catastrophe in the history of the American stage. Introduction. The idea for this book began before the advent of color television, the personal computer, the fax machine, or the internet. I developed a childhood interest in the disaster when I read a book called Lest We Forget, a compilation of press stories of the fire, some of them contradictory, published in 1904 as a means of raising money for the victims' families. When I read the late Walter Lord's A Night to Remember in 1955, I was struck by the similarities between the Iroquois tragedy and the Titanic disaster, which Lord so brilliantly documented. A magnificent ship, said to be unsinkable, and an equally magnificent theater, advertised as absolutely fireproof. A luxurious new vessel on its maiden voyage, and a luxurious new playhouse, open only a matter of weeks, presenting its dedicatory performance. The incredible human miscalculations. Not enough lifeboats on the ship, and virtually no firefighting equipment in the theater. A vessel possessing the new wireless technology that proved useless because the nearest ship did not receive its signals. And a theater boasting every modern convenience, but lacking any means to communicate by telephone or alarm with a fire station one block away. A ship running through a dark sea on orders from its owners, who ignored warnings of danger. A theater opened hastily by its owners, who ignored warnings that it was dangerously incomplete. The hubris and greed displayed by the owners of the ship and the owners of the theater. The terrible and inexcusable loss of life of passengers on the Titanic and of the audience in the Iroquois Theater. Many passengers on the ship locked behind gates. The theatergoers trapped behind locked and bolted gates and doors. The worldwide disbelief, horror, and outrage when the news of each disaster became known, and the reforms each catastrophe brought about. I have drawn heavily from accounts in the 1904 book, and have done original research in contemporary newspapers and magazines published in Chicago, New York, London, and other cities, and in accounts published later. My research began in 1961 in Chicago, when I interviewed former fire commissioner William Corrigan, who had fought the fire, and who gave me a detailed description of everything, from piles of snow in the street that day to the rescue attempts inside the burning theater. A few months later, while on assignment for CBS News, I had an opportunity to make repeated visits to the Chicago Historical Society to examine its materials on the disaster, including its extensive collection of photographs. More importantly, while I was in the city, I was able to record a lengthy interview with Charles Collins, who had covered the story as a young newspaper reporter. In response to public solicitations here and in England, I received letters from many people, including an AP reporter who was there, as well as a former Northwestern University student who had helped in the rescues. Though I had accumulated much research material, a career path that led to the Middle East, then to New York City, and eventually to Los Angeles and Santa Fe, prevented me from completing the story until now, 3 decades later. All the accounts in this book are based on original newspaper and magazine reports, on interviews and correspondence from the 1960s, and on conversations over the past 3 years with social historians, theater specialists, librarians, lawyers, doctors, forensic experts, fire department historians, and distant relatives of victims who had knowledge of the disaster. There are no fictionalized characters or quotations in these pages. Despite having spent most of his adult life as a writer, Charles Collins died without apparently leaving any memoir, diary, or journal describing highlights of his career. I interviewed him at length in 1962, and after he died 2 years later, I filled in some information on his early years from various sources. Contemporary newspaper accounts of the tragedy were, in some cases, contradictory or even mistaken, and owing to the poor quality of microfilm reproduction, often almost impossible to read, even with a magnifying glass. Perhaps the most difficult fact to pin down was the actual number of victims. The official list, as tabulated by the coroner's office, for instance, is missing the names of some victims mentioned in the Chicago papers. This is probably because of great initial confusion at the scene, and too, because some victims were removed by families who failed to notify authorities. News photography of the time was still in its infancy, dependent on bulky cameras, glass plate negatives, magnesium flash powder, which could sometimes injure cameramen, and the need for the subject usually to stand absolutely still to avoid blurring of the image. This would explain why most of the photographs of the theater's interior after the fire have more definition and detail than those shot in the street at the time of the fire, and would explain also why some Chicago newspapers quickly dispatched courtroom sketch artists to capture visuals that photographers were unable to record. A search around the country via the internet and through personal phone calls turned up little in the way of publicity shots of the Mr. Bluebeard production as it appeared on stage, either in New York or Chicago. That seems to me to be remarkable, given the fact that extensive production shots were taken of other shows that same year. The photo of the Pale Moonlight double octet is reprinted here, along with others, like the Pony Ballet Chorus, from sheet music published at the time. My thanks to Scott Stephen of Santa Fe for his deft digital engineering to restore many of the visuals to their original state, or even to enhance them. If there are errors or omissions in this account, I alone am responsible for them. Anthony P. Hatch, Santa Fe, New Mexico, December 2002. 1. Opening Night. A Glorious Place of Amusement. Amy Leslie, Arts Critic, Chicago Daily Tribune. The Iroquois Theater glowed like a luminous jewel between the darkened commercial buildings on Chicago's busy Randolph Street. Charles Collins, a new general assignment reporter who had just turned 20, had never seen anything like it. The theater's grand opening was being called the Event of Chicago's Century, and purely by chance, the Record Herald, the city's leading morning paper, had assigned Collins to cover it. It was the evening of Monday, November 23, 1903, when the Century seemed as young and optimistic as the tall, slim, neatly dressed reporter. "It was a fairly lush time," wrote one columnist years later. "We had come trumpeting out of the Spanish-American War with the buck-toothed image of Teddy Roosevelt, and we hadn't yet gone down the drain in the financial panic of 1907. After many postponements, the Iroquois was ready. A glittery million-dollar showplace that Proud City boosters declared was without doubt the best theater in the Midwest, and that would rival, if not exceed, anything seen along New York's Great White Way or in prominent European capitals. Chicago, America's second city now that it had surpassed Philadelphia in population, was described as on the make for the almighty dollar. Chicagoans would not settle for being second best in anything. Interest and excitement about the opening had gathered momentum during the fall, with newspaper ads proclaiming, "No resident of Chicago, imbued with the proper amount of local pride, can afford to miss the dedicatory performance of the best theater on earth." Chicago always leads. Biggest, brightest, and best in every other way, it now has the theater to correspond. Bundled against the biting cold, Charles Collins watched helmeted police officers in heavy woolen blue coats direct traffic as expensive $1,200 horse-drawn Studebaker broughams and Oldsmobile landaus, private omnibuses or opera buses, hansom cabs, rockaways, and even an occasional chauffeur-driven automobile pulled to the curb to discharge the city's Brahmins. Along with other shivering journalists, Collins eyed the crowd of elegant men and women emerging from the vehicles in top hats, tuxedos, furs, muffs, and the latest Paris fashions, who quickly crossed the pavement under a striped awning to walk through highly polished glass and mahogany doors into one of the most imposing playhouses ever built in America. The audience had come out on this cold November night, not only to see and be seen in the newest showplace in the nation, but to be entertained by a spectacle from London's Drury Lane Theatre, featuring a favorite son of Chicago, Eddie Foy, one of the leading comedians of the time, who headed a cast of hundreds. John G. Shedd, who in 3 years would head the Marshall Field Department Store, and would later endow the city's excellent aquarium, strode in, accompanied by his wife and daughter. Entering, too, was one of the city's biggest advertisers, Alexander Revel, the marketing genius who attracted hordes of customers to his furniture mart each day because of the fully furnished cottage he had set up on its fifth floor. Already occupying an upper box were the Plamondon brothers, George and Charles, owners of a large machinery plant. Charles, the firm's president and an official of the Chicago Board of Education, maintained a residence overlooking Lake Michigan and a country home in Wheaton called Green Gables. R. Hall McCormick of the McCormick Reaper family was there, along with Mr. and Mrs. Edward Light, who had given a dinner party before leaving for the theater. Mrs. Light wore a pink etamine gown, a white satin and lace coat, and a frilled hat of pink chiffon. Days earlier, many of these Chicago moguls had participated in a highly publicized auction where box seats for the opening night had gone for as much as $225, nearly 10 times Charles Collins's salary of $25 a week. Tonight, Collins was working as an unpaid theater critic, substituting for the Record Herald's noted drama critic, James O'Donnell Bennett, who was attending the premiere of Ulysses, which Bennett considered more worthwhile than Mr. Bluebeard, even though that British import was billed as a musical comedy extravaganza. Collins was well qualified to function as a critic. He had graduated from the University of Chicago the previous June with a degree in philosophy. His classmates described him as a strong, silent man, difficult to approach socially, with a slightly sardonic, wry sense of humor. From the time he entered the university, he knew he would become a journalist, and immediately after graduation he had joined the Record Herald, one of the two newspapers he had served as a campus correspondent, regularly phoning in sports scores and other items. He represented a new trend. For the first time in history, college graduates were working on newspapers. bringing a new literary flair to a world once considered beneath the dignity of the educated elite. His deeper love, however, was for the theater and virtually all forms of popular entertainment, and he harbored a secret desire to become a full-time theater critic. "Charlie knows his theater," said a friend. "He inwardly revels at the Stratford-on-Avon Shakespeareans, the doily cart Gilbert and Sullivanians. Barring revivals, he never sees a play twice." The opportunity to cover the opening performance in the Iroquois was a plum assignment. Collins, like most reporters, spent much of the day on his feet. There was no overtime pay, and it was quite common to get one day off every 2 weeks. Rumor had it that one fortunate newsman had scraped together enough money for a down payment on a wheel, as bicycles were called, to get from one assignment to another, but Collins's modest salary did not permit that luxury. As a new hand at the paper, he was probably sent to cover minor events like neighborhood pet shows, high school debating society finals, or conventions of the National Association of Paperclip Manufacturers. On occasion, he might land a more important assignment. To Chicago City officials, burdened with continuing revelations of corruption, accusations of immorality, and what must have seemed like endless labor strikes, the debut of the lavish theater not only offered a brief respite from their mundane problems, but was also a symbol of hope for the new millennium. The opulent playhouse was located in the heart of the city's great commercial loop, so named for the two-track Union Elevated trains, 1,600 of them a day, which twisted and ground above the downtown district like some giant species of screeching snake. By day, the area was choked with horse-drawn vehicular traffic, sidewalks crowded with visitors to the new high-rise office buildings, and to Marshall Fields, Mandel Brothers, Carson, Peary, Scott, and other fabulous retail emporia, and filled with the never-ending political hustle at the ugly, ponderous, block-long City Hall and County Building. At night, the area was so thick with theaters, hotels, restaurants, and wine rooms, as cabarets were then called, that it was becoming known as the Rialto of the Midwest. Collins, along with the rest of the local press corps, was overwhelmed by the physical splendor of the theater. The Record Herald's arch rival, the Chicago Tribune, would lose itself in superlatives, describing it as a virtual temple of beauty, a place where the noblest and highest in dramatic art could find a worthy home. Tribune typesetters had already blocked out the next day's theater page headline, "Beauty of Iroquois. One of the splendid theaters of the world opens with Mr. Bluebeard. Eddie Foy is welcomed." Under that headline, Amy Leslie, the Tribune's respected arts critic, wrote breathlessly, "No theater anywhere is handsomer than the Iroquois, a noble monument to dramatic art. Except L'Opera in Paris, no theater I ever saw is so resplendently spirited in its architecture. It is perhaps as glorious a place of amusement as Chicago shall care to demand." And the wonder of it all, as the Chicago Journal correctly noted, was that the marvels had been wrought in the short space of 6 months. On opening night, a group of friends entering the building exclaimed to one of the theater's owners, "You must have had Aladdin's lamp to accomplish all this." 2. Absolutely fireproof. "If this thing starts going, they will lynch you." Captain Patrick Jennings, Engine Company 13. The theater's debut had generated national interest for months. On its front page the previous May, the New York Times had reported, "Buildings in Dearborn and Randolph Streets, occupying the proposed site of the Iroquois Theater, are being raised for the new playhouse, which it is expected will be completed by October 12th, when Mr. Bluebeard will be given its Chicago opening." when the cornerstone was laid on July 28th. The San Francisco Chronicle carried a drawing of the Iroquois' main entrance below the headline, "Chicago to have a palatial theater." Its owners were officially listed as Will J. Davis and Harry Powers of Chicago, and their partners Claw and Erlinger of New York and Nixon and Zimmerman of Philadelphia. "It will be a syndicate house," noted the Chronicle, referring to the New York-based Theatrical Trust, which then controlled most of America's major theaters. Only steps away from where the broad cobblestone arteries of Dearborn and Randolph Streets intersected, and the new electric trolleys topped with pentagrams clutched a web of sparking overhead wires. The Iroquois formed a great L, extending from Randolph to a narrow alley, and in the rear, west to Dearborn. The stage occupied the toe of the L. The building's dimensions were impressive. Its frontage covered 61 feet along Randolph and extended 91 feet north to a lot fronting 110 feet on Dearborn. The main entrance on Randolph opened into a huge vestibule, foyer, grand promenade, and staircase, all of it at a sharp right angle to the auditorium and stage. Parallel to the six-story edifice and across a narrow 18-foot cobblestone alley were Northwestern University's schools of law, dentistry, pharmacology, and chemistry, in a building that had been the Tremont House Hotel. On the alley side of the theater were the scenery doors and fire escapes, and at the back of the theater was a small stage door adjoining an empty lot. Sandwiched between the dark stone Delaware office building on the corner and John Thompson's street-level restaurant, the Iroquois protruded boldly into Randolph Street, a Baroque palace in a block of nondescript four-story structures, stores, offices, a small hotel, and a bowling alley. Built of steel, brick, and concrete, materials considered impervious to fire, the theater and its furnishings represented an investment of $1.1 million. An astronomical sum at a time when $12 a week was considered a reasonable salary, and a Chicago working man's family existed on an average yearly income of $827. It seemed to Collins that no expense had been spared in building and outfitting the Iroquois. Its impressive French-style facade was polished granite and Bedford stone. Huge twin Corinthian columns, each weighing 32 tons, bracketed an entrance with 10 glass doors. Atop the columns were pilasters ornamented with the epic figures of comedy and tragedy, and the whole edifice was crowned with a broken pediment and a large carved stone bust of the theater's namesake Indian, an idea said to have originated with the theater's co-owner and manager, Will Davis, who owned a large collection of Americana. The interior was not only elegant, but the epitome of modern technology. 2,000 Edison Mazda bulbs blazed above and around the grand entry foyer and around a 6,300-foot auditorium, where seats were arranged so that everyone in the audience, whether in boxes, balcony, or gallery, had an unbroken view of a stage 60 feet wide by 110 feet deep. The stage floor had been designed to be much lower than standard, to permit people in the front rows a view from the footlights to the rear wall. The auditorium was second in size, only to that of the cavernous Chicago Municipal Auditorium. The ceiling towered 53 feet over the entrance hall, supported by 10 columns of Pavanazzo marble, bracketing a grand promenade. Its design, a blend of elements, adapted from both the U.S. Library of Congress and L'Opéra Comique in Paris. Ornate chandeliers and illuminated globes in the Beaux-Arts style lighted graceful, arched staircases bordered with filigree wrought iron balustrades, ascending to the box seats and upper tiers. Apart from walls of gleaming mirrors, the rich Indian red of the painted wall panels, and the dull gold of the arched ceiling, What space remained had been covered with seemingly endless yards of red and green plush velvet drapery. The seats in the auditorium were also covered with plush velvet and stuffed with hemp, as were the settees arranged around the promenade and the landings. Virtually nothing had been overlooked. High above the auditorium, the theater's ornate dome was circled by a frieze, illustrating the history of the Chicago stage, from the relatively primitive Rice Theater to the ultra-modern Iroquois. Backstage, out of the audience's sight, the opulence ended, but there were still many points of interest that stagehands were eager to point out. There were no fewer than 38 brick-walled dressing rooms, rising from the basement on different tiers, and capable of housing as many as 400 performers. A practical accommodation at a time when big musical productions often had casts of 300 or more, including very young children. A large electric elevator could whisk the actors silently and speedily from their dressing rooms to the stage, and the stagehands to the very top of the scenery loft. 11 miles of 2-inch greased manila rope were needed to support the Iroquois' main drop curtains and the approximately 280 heavily painted Bluebeard scenery flats, suspended from wooden battens high above the stage. Virtually all interior and stage lighting was controlled from a large central switchboard just off stage, its electric cable sheathed in heavy metal conduits. On opening night, the theater's wunderkind architect, handsome 29-year-old Benjamin H. Marshall, scion of one of Chicago's oldest families, sat with his parents and friends in a $200 box seat, listening to Will Davis deliver a rousing second-act curtain speech, interrupted by cheers and bursts of applause. Davis, gesturing toward the embarrassed young architect, assured the audience that it was no Aladdin's lamp that had caused the building to be completed in 5 months. But Ben Marshall, the George Fuller Construction Company, and other enterprising Chicago firms and workers. With barely concealed contempt for the Eastern Theater establishment, Davis said that the Iroquois was the creation of Western talent, abilities, and enthusiasm, that Western appreciation and encouragement were all that were desired, and they were good enough for any man. For the opening night audience, Davis and his partner Powers had produced a 30-page souvenir brochure with a red, gold-embossed cover, containing pictures of Benjamin Marshall, Davis, Powers, and their partners, along with sketches of the theater's entrance, lobby, promenade, magnificent twin staircases, and many other lesser features, including the smoking room, a clubby cave in the basement where men could retire between the acts to enjoy cigars and cigarettes while the ladies gossiped in the powder rooms. Charles Collins received one of these brochures. It said, in effect, that the Iroquois Theater was a magnificent creation, worthy in every respect of Chicago's self-image as a modern metropolis, and the sophisticated center of that other America that existed beyond the lights of Broadway and the Hudson River. The American public now, more than ever before, demand elegance of environment for their amusements, as well as provisions for comfort and security, the brochure stated in the florid language of the time. It noted the unstinted financial outlay, with a determination to secure the best as befitting such an important and artistic adventure, praised the ripe experience of the co-owners, Davis and Powers, and called the theater's builder, the George A. Fuller Company, second to none in handling enterprises of magnitude and in carrying them to completion in spite of all obstacles that the uncertain temper of the times may impose. The booklet was heavily illustrated, including photographs of the theater's New York minority shareowners and Bluebeard impresarios, the notorious, powerful Claw and Erlinger. For his part, Marshall had not been modest about describing his creation. He had studied architecture in Paris, had previously designed Powers Illinois Theater, and readily acknowledged that Chicago, still trying to forget the inferno that had nearly wiped out the city 32 years earlier, placed a great premium on safety. In public statements, Marshall emphasized that he had carefully studied every theater disaster in history to avoid errors in the design of his new building. In the unlikely event that an emergency should arise, he said, the Iroquois could be emptied within 5 minutes if all 30 exits were used. That message was further reinforced in the upper right-hand corner of the front page of each playbill handed to theater patrons. In bold, black type, it reassured the public that the Iroquois was absolutely fireproof. The claim might have been substantially altered, challenged, or completely eliminated, had anyone taken notice of a scathing report that had appeared in an obscure Chicago trade journal months earlier. Apparently, no one had paid any attention to an investigative piece in the August number of Fireproof magazine. Its editor, William Clendenin, had made an inspection of the theater while it was still under construction and had noted the absence of an intake or stage draft shaft, the exposed reinforcement of the concrete proscenium arch above the stage, the presence of wood trim on everything, and the inadequate provision of exits. There were other indications of trouble ahead. In a November 2nd report to Mayor Carter Harrison Jr. and the City Council, the building commissioner said that of virtually all the city's theaters, only the municipal auditorium met all safety code requirements. The structural conditions of the Iroquois were not included in the survey, because construction and fitting out of the interior was still underway, and the expectation was that the theater's management would complete all necessary changes and additions before the doors opened. For a metropolis growing as fast as Chicago, the building department was woefully undermanned, consisting of 19 inspectors, one fire escape inspector, 11 elevator inspectors, one ironworker, and three clerks, one of whom was responsible for issuing all permits. The alderman took the report under advisement, but to spare theater owners substantial added expenses, turned the survey back to the mayor, requesting a special committee to study the problem. The press paid little attention to what was, in effect, a tabling of the issue. Most disturbing of all was the result of a tour by an officer of the Chicago Fire Department that was not made public. In addition to having no ambulances, the department had no formal fire prevention bureau. One would not be established until 1911. The closest thing to a preventative measures unit was a small group called the Bureau of Explosives. But that, too, had neither the time nor the manpower to make inspections throughout the city. That job was apparently the responsibility of local battalion chiefs and their direct reports. Days before the official opening, the Iroquois was visited by Patrick Jennings, the respected captain of Engine Company 13, housed in a three-story building less than a city block from the theater. Because the Iroquois was in his jurisdiction, Paddy Jennings, as he was affectionately called by his men, made a routine inspection, accompanied by a department retiree named William Sallers, who had been hired as the Iroquois house fireman and who was required to be on hand for each performance. Jennings was appalled at what was missing. By 1903, telephones were no longer a novelty in Chicago, but the Iroquois had no backstage phone. In the auditorium, Jennings saw no exit signs, and some of the exits were concealed by thick drapery. But it was the absence of backstage appliances, as they were then called, that he found the most outrageous. There was no fire alarm system, no sprinkler system. Standpipes had not been connected. There were no backstage fire buckets or pike poles, and the number of fire hoses was totally inadequate. The only firefighting equipment in America's newest theater were six thin, 2-foot-long metal canisters, containing a popular dry chemical product called Killfire. The white powder inside each narrow 2-inch tube, according to label instructions, was to be forcibly thrown in a fan-like arc at the base of flames. The word forcibly was emphasized, as were the words never sprinkle. The instructions also included the information that Killfire, retailing for $3 a tube, could be used to control common household chimney blazes. Jennings demanded to know the reason for this obvious lack of equipment. Sallers replied that he feared for his job if he raised objections, and besides, the theater's management had been well aware of the problem for some time. Somewhat apologetically, Sallers confirmed that all he had on hand were the 6 canisters of Killfire. The infuriated Jennings was blunt. "If this thing starts going," he told Sallers, "they will lynch you." Jennings reported his findings to his superior, 1st Battalion Chief Jack Hannon, whose offices occupied the 3rd floor of Engine 13's station house. Jennings told his boss, "If a fire ever starts on that stage, it will be frightful." "What can we do about it?" Hannon was said to have answered. "The theater owners," he said, "have a fireman there, and they know all about it." In the Chicago Civil Service of the time, bucking a superior officer amounted to political suicide, to the instant termination of a career. The discussion was over. For Charles Collins, safety was not an issue. Overwhelmed by the Iroquois' luxurious appointments, he didn't notice any safety violations. But he did see something that struck him as disquieting. At the Randolph Street entrance, the monumental archway with its sculptural decorations looked, except for minor details, almost exactly like a monument erected in Paris to commemorate the deaths of 150 people who had lost their lives in a horrible flash fire in the city's 1897 Charity Bazaar. It was never recognized as such, Collins would later recall, and was only mentioned in shop talk among architects who had studied in the French capital. But the resemblance, he thought, was a sinister omen. 3. A New Year's Surprise. It is the new theater which is the talk of the town. Walter Hill, correspondent, New York Clipper. After the show on opening night, co-owners Davis and Powers held an informal reception to the accompaniment of popping champagne corks in the Iroquois' resplendent lobby. Collins had a review to turn in, and as he left the theater, he noted crowds of people, usually anxious to get home, lingering in the lobby to compliment the owners at length on their stunning accomplishment. They were congratulated by many people upon the handsome theater, which begins its career in their control. They, and many members of the cast, received floral tributes from all parts of the country, enough to fill out 3 or 4 greenhouses. The Chicago Journal observed, "Without a doubt, the audience that separated and went its many ways had less thought for the performance which had just been given than at any time in the history of a Chicago theater. It was the theater that all wished to see, not the Drury Lane spectacle presented by Claw and Erlinger." Walter K. Hill, Midwest correspondent for the theatrical trade paper The New York Clipper, forerunner of Variety, came to the same conclusion. The excitement was not about Bluebeard's songs and skits, its remarkable aerial ballet, Foy's comic routines, or even the beautiful young women who paraded past the footlights during the many spectacular tableaux. The story, said Hill, was the playhouse, not the show. "It is the new theater which is the talk of the town," he wired New York. "The house is the most beautiful in Chicago, and competent judges state that few theaters in America can rival its architectural perfections, the splendor of its decorations, or its facilities for comfort. The lobby is surprisingly beautiful. The auditorium is fitted luxuriantly, and the stage is commodious and perfect in every detail. The glittery opening must have impressed the entire audience, the prominent businessmen George Plamondon and Alexander Revel among them. They didn't have to wait to read the reviews. The elegance of the theater, combined with Mr. Bluebeard's music and dance spectacular, and especially Foy's zany routines, would be a perfect Christmas treat for their daughters. One, a teenage debutante, the other, a child of 7. A special Thanksgiving matinee was scheduled for the following day, but that was, of course, too early. With Christmas only weeks away, there were limited options for the children and their friends to see the spectacle. The most appropriate date would have to be a day close to the end of the year during school holidays, and it had to be an afternoon performance so that festive family dinners could be held immediately following the show. The Plamondon girl would be part of a group of friends, celebrating the return of a chum who had come home for the holidays from a school in Washington, D.C., and the Revel child would bring a little friend with her, along with the family maid. There seemed to be only one day on the calendar that would fit all these requirements. That would be the afternoon of December 30th, the Wednesday holiday matinee, little more than 5 weeks away. It would be a marvelous New Year's treat. 4. Strikes, snow, and show business. That is the most flammable goddamn mess of scenery I ever saw. Will J. Davis, co-owner, Iroquois Theater. In the winter of 1903, Charles Collins and his colleagues were delighted to note that the Record Herald's average daily circulation was 147,000 readers, jumping to just over 180,000 on Sundays, running far ahead of its morning rival, the Tribune. Chicago was a notoriously competitive newspaper town, and in the rough-and-tumble rivalry between the two morning dailies, the papers hustled after the same stories. But the way they handled the inaugural performance of the Iroquois Theater made it seem as if the opening had been staged in two different cities. On its theater page the morning after the opening, the Tribune ran an elaborate photo montage of the theater's promenade foyer, of Eddie Foy in one of his ludicrous costumes, and of the lovely young Chicago-born actress, Bonnie McGinn, a female lead. Its lengthy feature story about the theater and Amy Leslie's review of the Playhouse covered many columns, describing even minute details like a curtain of deep red velour used between scenes, a brilliantly colored autumn landscape on the act drop, and a woodland scene on the fireproof curtain. The Iroquois, the Tribune wrote on Sunday, challenges comparison as to beauty with any in the world. Charles Collins's review in the Record Herald, limited to two paragraphs in the music and drama column, was loaded with superlatives, although it seemed restrained in contrast to James Bennett's overblown 15-paragraph discussion of Ulysses. Collins described Bluebeard as a dazzling succession of stage pictures, each so brilliant and unique that its predecessor was instantly forgotten, each representing the pinnacle of the stage manager's and costumer's art, a gorgeous pageant. Music and mirth are subordinated to a spectacle which would stir the jaded imagination of a pleasure-sated Roman emperor. Eddie Foy bloomed out in his old-time form and was Lord High Jester of the Carnival. No one reported that at the time the Iroquois opened, both Fuller and Claw Erlinger were in serious financial difficulty, leading co-manager Davis to go out of his way to save money wherever he could. One item on which he cut expenses was the asbestos safety curtain. The George A. Fuller Construction Company, described in the souvenir brochure as second to none in handling enterprises of magnitude and carrying them to completion in spite of all obstacles, was in truth one of a handful of large general contractors that had both the manpower and special skills necessary to handle all aspects of building construction. with important contracts in New York, Boston, Pittsburgh, Chicago, and other major cities. It was the construction arm of the United States Realty and Construction Company. On November 12th, 11 days before the Iroquois was to open, with work by Fuller's Chicago employees still incomplete on the theater's roof ventilation system and exterior fire escapes, New York City bricklayers, 1,000 strong, struck all Fuller projects in the city. That included the new headquarters of the New York Times, the steel skeleton of which was then rising on Broadway at 42nd Street. Joined in sympathy by stonecutters and ironworkers, the bricklayers claimed they had been denied work when Fuller supplied not only fireproofing equipment, but used its own men for a job at a downtown Manhattan office building. The strike had an immediate effect. On November 18th, 5 days before the Iroquois was to open, Fuller announced major workforce reductions, leading to widespread reports that U.S. Realty would sever its ties with Fuller. Officials at Fuller's New York headquarters denied the reports, but confirmed that there had been considerable staff reductions, including workmen, due to the depressed state of the building industry brought about by unusual labor disturbances. The reductions were bound to have ramifications in Chicago and other cities. When, after several days, the New York bricklayer strike was finally settled, Fuller became the target of a second and far more serious walkout. This time, it was Local 2 of the New York ironworkers, who objected to the subletting of ornamental work on another Manhattan project. Though Fuller quickly signed an agreement with a new ironworkers union, S.P. McConnell, the company's president, acknowledged on November 24th, the day after the Iroquois gala opening, that the strike against Fuller was going to expand to other cities. The Iroquois had opened for business, but the building was not yet completed. November of 1903 also spelled trouble for two of the most powerful names in the theater industry, Mark Claw and Abraham Lincoln Erlanger. These two, who called themselves booking agents, controlled, along with other partners, the vast theatrical trust from their offices on South Broadway. At the time, American business was going through a major metamorphosis, from freewheeling competition to loosely knit cartels to airtight trusts. Though minuscule compared to giants like John D. Rockefeller's Standard Oil or the Southern Pacific Railroad, the theatrical trust was the most powerful monopoly in the world of vaudeville and the legitimate stage. Its business practices emulated America's largest corporate combinations by centralizing control, absorbing and eliminating competitors, and crushing labor opposition. Created in 1896, by 1903, the trust, also known as the syndicate, controlled most, if not all, of the important legitimate theaters in the country. Weeks before the Iroquois debut, Claw and Erlanger had opened their stunning New Amsterdam Theater on West 42nd Street in Manhattan, the largest stage in New York. It was said to have been built expressly for musical productions, a monument to the musical's ascendancy to a position of artistic and financial respectability. Respectable was not a word used often to describe the Claw-Erlanger organization, which was frequently referred to as the Skindicat. Mark Claw was a thin, cadaverous lawyer from Louisville, who had worked briefly as a newspaper man and as a press agent. With penetrating eyes and a neatly cropped mustache and beard, he was a natural diplomatist, suave and easy in his converse with men. His partner and opposite was Abraham Lincoln Erlanger, a crude little man with a billiard ball head, who had begun his theatrical career selling tickets in a Cleveland box office. Erlanger was a punitive, rancorous bundle of energy, a bully who kept busts of Napoleon in his office, and enjoyed acting like the little corporal. He once rudely responded to a theatergoer who complained about the $2 price of an orchestra seat. In answer to your letter, we would suggest that you borrow a dictionary and look up the word impertinence. These two were possibly the most feared men in what was then called the show business. To describe them as booking agents was a gross misstatement. Over the years since the trust had begun taking over leases of most of the available first-class theaters in the nation, it had consolidated a substantial amount of power. Through their network of local resident theater owners and managers, Claw Erlanger had the power to decide who and what would play in the many theaters under their control. They were ruthless, often demanding and getting as much as 50% of a show's gross profits, as well as hefty add-on commissions from advertising, publicity, booking, and other service fees. If an independent theater operator would not agree to their terms, they could permanently darken his stage, eventually shutting him down, by steadily withholding anything but second- or third-rate performers and equally undistinguished productions. They played their good-guy-bad-guy roles often, and according to one theater historian, extremely well. Managers from the hinterland, who'd been pulverized by Erlanger's imperious edicts, could be rehabilitated by Claw's unctuous attentions. But each man, in his own manner, was out for the same thing: utter domination of the American stage. Though unknown to most of the general public, Claw and Erlanger were detested not only by many actors and independent theater owners, but even by some members of the press, who saw them as more than another monopoly to be destroyed, agreeing with many leading clergymen of the day that the trust was responsible for the degradation of the American theater and the corruption of Christian morals. It was easy to dislike Mark Claw and Abe Erlanger. They were powerful and ruthless, wealthy and arrogant, and they were Jews. Among the prominent, outspoken holdouts against the trust were the French actress Sarah Bernhardt and Minnie Madden Fisk, the first lady of the American stage, whose husband and manager, Harrison Gray Fisk, was the powerful editor and publisher of New York's Dramatic Mirror. In subtly anti-Semitic rhetoric, Fisk railed against the syndicate's greed, cunning, and inhuman selfishness. But Fisk's innuendos were mild compared to the Jew-baiting of Life magazine's drama critic James S. Metcalf. Life was founded in 1883 by three Harvard graduates.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.